Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, in case you're joining us for the first time, we do air every Thursdays at 10 p.m. here on Urban TV. And better still, you can catch the repeat on Saturdays at 8 in the morning. Or for those of you that are on the move, our socials are right there. You can watch us on YouTube or Facebook Live. All this is there for you to ensure that you get the latest infos about how you can grow your business. Talking infos, so much has happened. Including, there's an interesting story here of the IMF okaying 440 billion loan to Uganda after reforms. It's a conversation for another day, but your question is, so we've just gotten into the new financial year 23-24 and we're already taking more money. What happened to the budget? I don't know. Let's talk how to make money for this week.
My name is Chigundu Silas. I'm the team leader, Chibajo Enterprises.
Okay.
So Chibajo adds value to Jinja into finished product. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, for all the generations, most of our Jinja has been exported to other countries, but those people come and buy it here, even Kenyans, at very, very low prices, and now take it, add value on it, and bring it back in finished products. Like powdered foam, and they said it expensive to the Ugandans, yet even the farmers were cheated. And as Cyrus, who grew up in Butambala, as early as 3 years, I was taking care of ginger on the ginger farms of my family. Mm. So my dad and my mom were all peasant farmers. No one had ever gone to school.
Yep.
They were doing ginger.
Okay.
And now like another life started in July 2002 when my dad got an accident. So he got an accident and all his limbs got damaged. He could not do any more farming. So all the money he could get from the ginger after being cheated by the middleman could support taking him to Mulago for the nursing payments, for reviews, and also buying the necessities, food, kerosene for the third over at home, and all other those basic necessities.
Okay.
Yeah. All so, right. Now, what I had to do is to take care of on other people's farms so that to get the school fees to reach high school.
Okay.
Now, when I reached high school, I had no more money to go to university. And then I started trying to see how I can achieve my dreams even before going to university. And I decided to become an entrepreneur. And now creating a solution, supporting farmers from my ginger growing region.
Okay, so it kind of sounds like you don't have to really go through university to be an entrepreneur or to be successful or do something that is tangible in society. Because look, your story is a bit touching from the start, but now let's talk about how then from a young boy that was growing up on the farm, you know, watching over the ginga grow, where did you get the idea to start adding value and how was it starting?
As I've told you, the farmers have been cheated by the middleman. And then when you go to the supermarket, you find ginger from Kenya, from Nairobi, a kilogram sold over 80,000. And this ginger is even not pure. They are additives, so after using it for 2 weeks, it's not pure. And I was like, it means if we make a finished product, but we as Ugandans here, but yet on it's based on fair trade, when the farmers are benefiting, and also Ugandans are getting this ginger at low prices, because the need is there.
Yeah.
Everyone uses ginger.
That's right.
If you don't use ginger for tea spicing home, you use it to make COVID concoctions. Because you remember previously,
yeah, I do.
You add ginger with lemon and garlic, and then you make those immune boosters.
Yeah.
You know, people who cook home, like the mothers, the wives, they use it to make soups,
rice, yeah.
To make different types of dishes. So ginger can be used like to do a lot of things at home.
Okay.
And even at the industrial processing level to make biscuits, chocolates. So there was a big opportunity and no one was coming to bridge the gap. And maybe they were waiting for the entrepreneur coming from the region who has the direct plane with the ginger farmers.
Yeah.
Because I know what the farmers are going through by being paid of peanuts from the middleman.
Okay. So I can see you're holding the one you started with, when you started processing.
Yes.
So how was that journey, starting with that small, ordinary, you know, processing and packaging like that? How was it?
So this journey is very interesting, full of lessons and learnings. So in April last year, 2021, I went back to Tambala. I talked to 5 farmers about this amazing idea, which I'm going to be building an inclusive value ginger chain in Uganda. Mm. And out of the 5, 3 got intrigued and excited. Each gave me 20 kilograms of ginger, fresh one. So I worked on the ginger myself and the mom. So I took the ginger to the water, to the well. I washed and removed all the soil, brought it back home. And now we cut it with the knives into slices for easy drying. Now on the tarpaulin. So after drying it, I got a local mortar.
Yeah.
You know Ichinu, people use to make ginats, cassava flour.
Yeah.
And I also got the sieve, the local one people use.
And
now I sieved. So these small bovelas can be gotten like in Chiembe, or you know, I got these small bovelas, so I could, which people even use for other these normal products.
And
And then I was packing like 20 to 50 grams, and then first I cited 15 people who could be potential customers from different groups. From the elite working class and the normal, and then I gave 15 people, and everyone was like, wow, what a product. What is missing is only the packaging, but we've never tested any pure ginger ever. I was like, I've been sitting on this golden opportunity all the time. So those people made even orders before I started producing. So now I had to look for other youths who could be interested, because my saving were not enough.
That's right.
I looked for other 2 youths. I told them about my vision, the golden opportunity, and also how we are going to be impacting the farmers.
Okay.
Not only getting money, but also changing their lives. We listed some funds. Now we got a locally made machine for grinding. We also got some packaging, like first class.
Now I'm going to hold it at that first, because before we cross that packaging, how was it then for you trying to find? You said guys loved the other one and told you needed to improve on your marketing, I mean your branding.
On the brand.
How did you then improve, apart from just saying you got money from your other friends to improve this?
Yeah.
How was that journey, trying to ensure that now you make something better that can appeal to, you know, better clients than maybe the people in Butamba?
Ah, it was really of baby steps. From April, I launched Chibajo in July. It took me other 3 months to launch the product. By all that time, I was doing the grinding, trying to grind using different measures, and also giving to different people to tell me, is there a difference in quality? Is it the same? I also tried using these exotic breeds to see. And then the customers were like, no, we need the other first pure product, the one of Chibajo. Because for to the farmers, Chibajo means the indigenous breed of that ginger. And now, after 5 people buying, they took and even gave to different friends. I have one of a friend from the like who was having a mzungu lady, and then she was like, okay, now the product is good, but you need to get packaging. I started looking for different packagings, and they were not a bit top notch.
Yeah.
I wanted to make that final product. Whereby you can find it in any supermarket outside Uganda, in Carrefour, in Mega, in Capital Shoppers, anywhere, and you can buy it, and it looks like an international product.
Okay.
So it took me more 3 months to get to reach to this perfect product.
So reaching to this perfect product, what lessons as a young entrepreneur did you learn from starting small to where you are? What are some of the lessons you learned that maybe someone watching could pay attention to and say, oh wait, I think I need to do ABCD before I go to EFG?
Okay, so as the vision bearer, someone who understands your idea, you need to know this from the beginning, that you need to involve yourself in doing the dirty work. I mean the first practical work. As I've told you, I had to go on ground, do everything so that I could have this the prototype, which I had to take to people for validation, if the product is really good for them. And then even to the team, I had to, you know, to entice and intrigue them to come on board. I had to first have a product, you know, to show them that it's, you know, this thing is workable, it's profitable, you know, it's a product needed. I had to do research. So you have to involve yourself in doing research, especially on the market.
That's right.
Is the market really there?
Yes.
So after knowing that the market is there, because it makes no sense to make a product which has no market out there.
Yeah.
And then secondly, I've told you that I took it to 15 people.
Right.
To tally, yeah, and you know, is this really important? That tells you that I really knew that I'm not making this product for me. Yeah, I was taking Chivajo in the raw form, but I wanted other people who don't have time to get a big stick, stone, mulao, and start pounding.
Yeah.
Yes, and I took it to them over 3 times to do the validation and tell me to improve. So you need to know that you are making this product for people. You have to listen to the customers. You are not your customer. The customer is out there.
That's
and
right.
Then you make the product to them. Even the branding, even everything should be meeting the needs
of the customer.
Of the customer.
All right, so it's popular to say the customer is the king.
Yes.
And probably the lesson there for the people watching is always ensure that you're one, solving a community problem when
yes.
you're starting a business, but also do not put your interests in your business so much. Whatever you're producing is for the people out
yeah.
there. So ensure that you meet their interests, not your interests. Now, what has been your turnaround when you upgraded to this other packaging now? What has been the turnaround for the business?
The turnaround has been very interesting.
Okay.
Because, you know, that customers mostly, in today's world, they buy packaging.
That's right.
Yes. So, 70% of my customers buy because of the packaging.
It but looks the quality must be good as
at
well.
At first, some of them,
yeah,
they tell me, no, I bought your product because it was looking, you know, very nice. But do you know what is surprising and amazing? When I took it home, it is still now the best product because there's no ginger I've tested,
yeah,
which is pure. And even after using it for months,
yeah,
the purity does not decrease. It remains pure as if we bought it yesterday. So the packaging has also supported me,
yeah,
you know, to have a nice product,
okay,
and also take it out there. It speaks to itself. When you find it there, you know, you see it's rare to find
yes.
these other products apart from coffee packaged
yeah,
in
that
name,
package, that
you know
good. That's right,
yeah,
that's
so
right.
it's the top-notch packaging has also helped me to go even beyond.
Is it that expensive? Does it make the business sense for you? Very nice packaging. At the end of the day, when you compute how much you put in packaging vis-a-vis the returns, do you make break even as a business person?
We've not made the break even because we are 8 months old.
Okay.
Yeah, but we are making sales. Okay, it's a bit high.
Yeah.
But when you buy in bulk, it's a bit low.
But how does your projection look as a business person? So you have this now, you're saying, okay, if we can produce this, we estimate that this will be the sales and this will be the returns. Does it look clear to you where you're heading as a business person?
With the market expansion,
yeah,
which comes in, and even now, you know, we've been making sales for the past 8 months without even the UNBS. Now we are in the process of the certification of the UNBS because we are having the best product. A lot of customers, you know, there's my customer in Fiji. He was
yeah.
like yesterday, you know, I'm your UNBS. If someone asks about the UNBS mark, tell them,
yeah,
I already certified. I have never tested any pure ginger powder like this.
Yeah.
The guy also does ginger growing, but he's no longer wanting to take the roots. The roots.
What's the process
now,
going?
He wants the process.
So I can imagine processing involves a bit of work as well. There's
yes.
maybe there's electricity or something like
yeah.
that. How is the cost of production generally for a young entrepreneur like you?
Yeah, and before even the cost,
yeah,
we are currently employing 30 women in Butambala who
do the
post-harvest.
Okay.
Who do the post-harvest, like from the washing of the ginger,
so that's from
to
the
cutting
garden,
of the ginger,
yeah,
and the drying, because the drying takes like 2 weeks,
okay,
during sunny days.
Okay.
So you always have to cover it at around 5 and open it in the morning,
yeah,
and then you come and disintegrate it, like you don't leave it at
just
one big piece. Yeah, not squeezed.
Spread it a bit. So
spread it a
air.
Bit.
Yeah.
Oh, so there are 30 women who does that when we are going when we are doing the post-harvest cycle.
Mm.
And then we also have like other three workers, part of the team, now where we are doing the processing. So after drying, we bring it to now Chitem on Masaka Road, where we do the grinding, and now we make this fine product.
Okay.
Yeah. And
operation costs?
And the operation
is it
cost.
High?
It's not so high.
Yeah.
It would have been high, but for me, it's more, it's advantageous to me because I don't need any middleman in the value chain. As I told you, I grew up in Butambala. I know from the first one to the last ginger farmer. So I get ginger from Butambala and I employ people from Butambala. So there's no middleman amidst the whole value addition chain.
Okay.
So that supports me to eliminate a lot of costs which would have been getting within the middleman.
Okay.
But still we are doing a lot of costs in line with electricity, also renting.
Yeah.
But as you know, as we are progressing, the more the market expands, the more sales, and then we are able to cover those indirect and direct costs.
Right, so there you have it on how to make money for this week. So I keep saying when you're done making the money, then you probably start thinking of how do I save it or how do I spend it? Or better still, for you that is looking for an opportunity to start making money through starting a business, you're probably worried about taking loans from the banks or loan sharks around the city. So let's talk you then through personal finance tips for this week. And in part three of our four-part series on personal finance, we are this week talking to the CEO of Med Business Consult, and we are talking sources for financing. Is it possible for you to look at partnerships or strategic deals that can help you sign for money that does not come with so much in terms of interest, but also even sponsorships are deals that can work for you? Let me run you through this conversation on personal finance tips for this week.
Hi, good evening viewers. This is Enoch Mbeine, your business coach. Welcome to yet another episode of The Business Show. Last week, we talked about the various external sources of finance for our businesses. And this week, we are going to look at the other various ways, the many various ways of accessing finances. And firstly, let's look at the vendor credit. Vendor credit is when a particular vendor or somebody who is supplying you raw materials supplies you on credit for you to implement your business operations. So this is one of them. The other one is what we call factoring. Factoring is when you sell your account receivables to a third party who is normally called a factor in exchange, usually for cash. So factoring is another way of raising funds or sources of funding for your company. Then there's what we call peer-to-peer lending. With peer-to-peer lending, this is lending between individuals or friends who put together money and lend each other. This is usually, for example, in a company or in a family or in an organization. So it's another way of how we can attract funding from friends, peer-to-peer lending. Then there's another common way which is now getting popular in Uganda called crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is where people come together and put money in one basket. And in this basket, this is the money they are able to lend you as a business for your operations. And usually, with crowdfunding, you can get information about these people maybe on the internet or out there in the public. People are there, they want to lend you money. Another very good way of how you can raise funds is looking at the leasing option. Leasing option is where you write a written agreement with Elisa to supply an equipment that you can use and pay at a later date. So here you as a company can acquire an asset without actually putting in your money. So leasing can also be a very good option. Then around our ecosystem, our business ecosystem, we have what we call private grants. These are grants from private institutions, private individuals who are interested, for example, in funding something for a particular cause, maybe funding an enterprise in the area of health, in the area of conserving the environment. Personal fund, private funds, grants are one other source, good source of funding for your enterprise, and especially when we look at a social enterprise. Then also, there are various business support agencies out there who are very interested in supporting you. And these agencies are looking at also empowering various people, for example, the youth. We look at women empowerment, minority groups. All these people, all these organizations are out there to give you these funds. And this would be a very good way of raising funds. One good example, for example, is currently MasterCard. MasterCard Foundation would be one good business support agency that can give you grants if you come up with a very unique and innovative idea, and especially in the area of youth employment, they would be willing to listen to you. Another way is through government grants. These are grants that are given by the government to help you set up a certain enterprise in a certain area so that you're able to address certain issues. Let me give an example. It could be a grant to set up a tourism facility to be able to create employment. It could be a grant to set up a health facility so that you're able to address health issues in that community. But this is usually a grant from the government. Then also we have strategic partnerships. These are partnerships where organizations come in and share certain costs with you. They'll, for example, say, we shall take care of your administration costs, we shall take care of the operation costs, you concentrate on the manufacturing side. And these organizations have an interest to see that your organization grows. So these strategic partnerships are also very, very key in helping you to leverage funds and raise funds for your organization. So ladies and gentlemen, those are some of the other various ways on how we can raise funds for our organizations or businesses. I thank you.
So there you have it. You do not have to worry so much about how to get money. All you need to do is to strategize. And when we're talking about funding from partners, probably this is the time now where you need to think of what kind of business am I starting? Is it a business that sorts societal problems, or it is a business that you're thinking to only help you as the owner make money, close and go home? I keep saying, start a business that has solutions to the real challenges in society. Such businesses attract funding from donors who want to, let's say, for instance, conserve the environment, you know. So think through, you do not have to go to banks to start a business. You can either get partnerships or sign deals with different sponsors and see how you can get this money that is more or less, you know, sometimes has interest, but maybe slightly lower than what would be charged in the banks. Personal finance for this week. Let's then talk you through Forex and money markets. I did see Uganda Cleese posted some good billions in profit after taxes. Here's a comprehensive report now. Well, I guess I have to go, you know, but there's so much happening in the world of business, including a recent book, Walking with Gorillas. It was launched here in Kampala by Dr. Gladys Kalema Zikusoka, and it's talking about how to conserve the environment, but also protecting gorillas. One interesting thing that stood out during the launch is the American government did reaffirm their commitment to sponsoring training.